Okay, good morning. Welcome to week number two of summer 2020. I hope everybody got through the first week okay. I'm going to talk about ancient Egypt today. So this is your first video of two for this week. So ancient Egypt. Alright, first thing you have to know about the ancient Egyptian culture is the Nile River. It's kind of the lifeblood of the people. I've got a map here on the right hand side to kind of show you what it looks like, and you can see it's really, really long. It's over 4,000 miles, and it flows from the south, so it starts near Lake Victoria in the south, and it flows north as the White Nile near the city of Khartoum, Sudan. It joins with the Blue Nile, and then it flows through the desert until it gets to the Mediterranean Sea. The Nile is really important because it floods predictably. Most of the water comes from the Blue Nile. Most of the water comes from these heavy rains that happen in Ethiopia, and they're yearly rains, and so the flooding of the water is very, very predictable. And these floods are going to protect the Egyptians from starvation because the flood water is going to replenish the soil and give it new nutrients. There are other uses of the Nile as well. It's used for transportation. I mean, after all, it is a river. A food source, the birds near it, and fish in it. And then there are these reeds, these plants that grow on the banks of it that are known as papyrus. They would dry out the papyrus, they would roll it out, and then they would write on it. And that's actually where our idea of paper comes from. Now, from 3500 to 2800 BC, we have this period called pre-dynastic Egypt. And during this time, Egypt's divided into two different kingdoms. You've got the upper kingdom, you've got the lower kingdom. The upper kingdom is upriver. It is on the south part of Egypt, because remember, the Nile River flows backwards at the city of Luxor. And then the lower kingdom is located where the Nile River meets the Mediterranean Sea. Now, during this time, the Egyptians are going to develop tool usage. They're going to learn how to irrigate. They're going to learn how to plant. And during this time, the basics of Egyptian culture are going to develop. You also get the development of the Egyptian religion, too. Now, somewhere between 3150 and 3100 BC, an Egyptian king named Narmer, and you see there I have in parentheses Menes. Depending on the literature you're reading, you might see both names, but most Egyptologists and historians now say Narmer and Menes were the same. He is going to fully unify the upper and lower kingdoms and is going to establish what becomes known as the First Dynasty. And once all of Egypt is united, that's going to become known as the Old Kingdom. Now, the Old Kingdom is where most of the cool stuff happens. First of all, the kings are going to be absolute rulers. Everybody works for the king. The government officials work for the king, the peasants work for the king, the slaves work for the king, the artisans work for the king. Everybody works for the king. They trade with their partners a lot. The biggest trading partner was to their south, the Kingdom of Nubia, which would be located in modern-day Ethiopia and Sudan. And then, just to kind of show you how powerful these kings were, you got to look at the pyramids. I've got a picture of the pyramids there, and notice it looks like they are out in the middle of nowhere. Well, what a lot of people don't realize is if you were to turn that camera around 180 degrees and look behind them, there's actually a huge major city there, the city of Giza. But this picture is better. It makes it look like they're in the middle of the desert. They're really not. But the largest pyramid is for the King Khufu, and it's known as the Great Pyramid. And we have no idea how the pyramids were actually built. There are lots of different ideas. Some people say they were built from the inside. Some people say they were built from the outside. The only thing we know is that they're really big. There's a Greek historian named Herodotus who reported that it took 100,000 men more than 20 years to build them. And we used to think that it was slave labor, but that has changed. We now know that they were paid workers who worked for 20 years to build these things. We also know that the largest pyramid, known as the Great Pyramid, had about 2.3 million stone blocks, and each of those blocks weighed 2.5 tons. And that's why we're not exactly sure how it was built, because I don't want to lift 2.5 million tons and put it right at the top. Religion in the Old Kingdom. Hopefully you know a little bit about Egyptian religion. It's polytheistic. There's lots of gods, and I have them listed here. It's also circular, meaning that it follows the cycles of nature. Some of the bigger gods are Ra or Amun, who is the sun god, Osiris, who's the god of the afterlife, Horus, who's the son of Osiris and Isis, and Anubis, the god of the underworld. And there's also stories and mythology that go around them. For example, once upon a time, Osiris was the ruler of the dead. Or he is the ruler of the dead now, but he used to be the god of fertility. And for whatever reason, Horus got jealous of Osiris, murdered him, cut his body into pieces, and then the wife of Osiris, named Isis, had to put him back together. And because Isis gave life, or I should say Isis gave a second life to Osiris, she became the goddess of fertility, and Osiris became the god of afterlife because he was born again, a second life, so to speak. There are other gods, there are local gods, they serve villages, so don't think it's just that list. There are lesser gods as well. The Egyptians also believe in an afterlife, and I think it's a great reward. There's lots of duck hunting and boating and fun stuff. And the kings are going to become more powerful. The government administrators are going to be more important in the afterlife. It's almost like a level up or a promotion in their eyes. And you probably know about Egyptian mummies, but you may not know why they do that. Egyptian mummies, it's where they embalm bodies and they preserve them. It's because they thought that once they were judged and made it to their afterlife, they would re-inhabit their bodies. And because they thought they would re-inhabit their bodies, their tombs are filled with their favorite things, their favorite possessions, their favorite wine cups. In some cases, their pets are even put in the tomb with them, and in some cases, if they're wealthy, their servants are buried with them too. There are often statues placed in the tomb, because if something happens to the body, the statue is what their spirit would inherit or inhabit. And there was this very important book, probably the most important book in ancient Egypt, called the Book of the Dead. And it provided burial instructions on what to do when somebody died, but it also included the instructions on how to get to the afterlife. Think of it almost like a gamer guide or a cheat guide. There were certain adventures or certain events that the spirit was supposed to go through, and the Book of the Dead was supposed to teach you how to do that. If for some reason the spirit did not make it to the afterlife, then they would be eaten by the great devourer. And one other thing about their religion, and this is kind of religion and philosophy, it's this idea of Maat, M-A-A-T, or you might see it M-A apostrophe A-T. Same thing. Most Egyptologists, they consider this right order. Think of it like everything has to be in balance. If everything is in balance, if everything is in order, the gods are happy, and it creates this idea of mat that keeps everything together. If something happens where mat is not obtained, there could be floods, there could be locusts, whatever it might be. What mat was really used for was kind of a way to keep people in line, in balance, promote order, if you will. Because the king would say, hey, we're not in mat, something could happen to us. And so people would start doing what they're supposed to do. Ancient Egyptian writing, hieroglyphics. And I've got a picture here of some basic hieroglyphics to give you an idea what they look like. We actually can read hieroglyphics. In 1798, while this guy named Napoleon had his army marching around the Egyptian desert, they found this three-sided stone that was buried in sand, and when they uncovered it, they found that there were carvings on it on one side, and then on another side there was Greek writing, and they were able to compare the two and figured out, hey, we can read hieroglyphics. Hieroglyphics were translated by 1814, so it only takes about 15 years or so to find the Rosetta Stone and then to read the hieroglyphics. Hieroglyphics, they contain three different parts. There's the phonograms, the ideograms, and the determinants. The phonograms are the signs that represent sounds. A great example, in hieroglyphics, a small oval can represent the sound ra or R. Ideograms represent an entire idea. The small oval can represent a mouth. So it can be either or. And then the determinative, it's the unspoken context. So you don't speak a determinative, but the determinative helps you realize what the phonograms and the ideograms are. The other thing about hieroglyphics, they can be written any way. You have to look at the way the faces are looking, and that's how you know which way to read the sentence, if you will. There are no vowels in hieroglyphics. And when you put it all together, they're able to write this really impressive literature. In their literature, we can read it. The papyrus, in many cases, was preserved because of the dry climate. So we know that their literature is about their myths, their afterlives, their religion. They also write about their kings, victories at war, and wisdom in Proverbs as well. The Egyptians are known for their math and their medicine. They are one of the first people to use applied science. They had to use the science, they had to master things like geometry and arithmetic and surveying, so that they could control the floodwaters of the Nile, and they could plant and they could irrigate all the land. Plus, the pyramids, that's them putting applied science and math into building. The pyramid, the base of it is a perfect square, and the angle of the pyramid is perfect so that it will not fall in on itself and will not fall out on itself. So it's a unique and impressive feat of architecture. All right, their medicine, yes, driving demons out of the body and all that stuff, but it still is going to form the basis of modern medicine. And what I mean by that is the Egyptians, they would try to seek out and find reasonable diagnoses, and when they couldn't come up with reasonable diagnoses, well, it must be demons, let's get rid of the demons. So they performed triage. They had three different levels. They had completely curable people that they took good care of. They had conditions that were treatable. Think of these like lifelong chronic situations, such as maybe diabetes or something. Then they had terminal conditions where they just kind of eased your pain and then let you die. And there are 48 different conditions or diagnoses that the Egyptians made that are more or less still recognized today by medical professionals. All right, all good things come to an end. The Old Kingdom is no difference. For whatever reason, somewhere around 2100 BC, the power of the Old Kingdom declined. Some people say they just got bored and everything stagnated. And a famine, civil war, it all develops. And eventually around 2000 BC, the old pharaohs, or the old kings, kind of die out. And this guy named Mentuhotep, he's going to take over. He's going to reunify Egypt after all the civil wars, and he's going to declare the pharaohs to be living gods. He gives himself an upgrade, if you will. In the Middle Kingdom, it only lasts for about 300 years or so, until this group of people known as the Hyksos invade Egypt. Now, we don't know where the Hyksos came from. Some people say they came from where modern-day Turkey is. Others say they came from southern Africa. Historians don't actually know. The only thing we do know is they come to Egypt, they destroy the Middle Kingdom, they rule for about 150 years, and then the Egyptians get rid of them. Now the Hyksos, they bring horses to Egypt, they bring bows to Egypt, they bring axes to Egypt, and I've even read that they're the ones that bring chariots to Egypt. But when the Egyptians defeat the Hyksos, that's going to lead to the New Kingdom. And there's not a whole lot about the New Kingdom that I'm going to tell you, because most of the ancient Egyptian stuff happens in the Old Kingdom. But before I do the New Kingdom, I have to tell you, it's time for the secret word. The secret word for today is going to be mummy. It's only appropriate because we're talking about Egypt. The secret word is mummy, M-U-M-M-Y. Okay, so the New Kingdom, 1570 or so to about 1000 BC. And this is where the pharaohs or the kings become gods. The Hyksos, they're defeated by Ahmose the First. He establishes a new kingdom. He says, I did this because I'm divine. Then after him, there's a guy named Amunhotep. He's treated as a living god and builds the Great Temple of Karnak, which was the biggest building of its time. And then Thutmose the First builds the Valley of the Kings. And Thutmose II, he's kind of weird. He marries his wife or sister. We're not sure of the connection. He could have been wife and sister for all we know. But Thutmose marries Hatshepsut. And Hatshepsut, after Thutmose dies, gets rid of her stepson and rules as a pharaoh herself. She dresses as a man because that was a symbol of power. She wore a false beard because that was a symbol of power. And she lived like a god. Now, when Hatshepsut dies, her stepson, Thutmose III, tries to destroy all record of his stepmom, and it's really only been in, I think, the last 30 or 40 years that Hatshepsut has come to light and we know about her. Now, moving on from her, there's another pharaoh named Amunhotep IV who marries Nefertiti. And they're going to completely change religion, and this is known as the Amarna Revolution. Amenhotep and Nefertiti, because they're tired of the priests and everybody, all the government officials having so much power, he's going to declare a new religion. And this is going to be a monotheistic religion. He's going to say there's only one god, that one god is Aton, and it's this combination of the two other gods, Amun and Ra. They're combined together like Voltron or Transformers or something, and they become known as Aton. Amenhotep renames himself Akhenaten, which means one who serves Aton, and he's basically going to make everybody mad. In fact, Amenhotep, or Akhenaten, whatever you want to call him, is murdered in a palace coup. He is taken over. He is actually so unlike that he has to move his capital to the middle of the desert. And his capital city, known as Amarna, has only recently, in the last 75 years or so, been uncovered and explored. Now what happens after that? His son, King Tutankhamun, or King Tut, takes over, and King Tut basically undoes everything that his father did. Now King Tut is also the most famous mummy. And he's kind of like the Kardashian of the days. He's famous just for being famous. He was famous because when grave robbers, or I mean explorers, found his tomb in 1922, it was the most complete tomb that had been found up to that time. So King Tut, he's famous for being famous. Now what's interesting about him, he becomes king when he's very young, he's in his early teens, he dies in his late teens, and they found that he died probably of a massive trauma to his leg. They also found that he was probably, how should I say, inbred. The family tree didn't go very far, and he had really bad scoliosis to the point that he probably couldn't walk without help. Now what happens to the ancient Egyptians? Well, in the mid-8th century, a group of people called the Assyrians, remember we talked about them last week, invade Egypt, and they destroy Egypt's power as a civilization. Okay, so that's all you need to know about ancient Egypt for this class. You'll have another video on Wednesday where we talk about Judaism. Once again, I hope everybody made it through the first week okay, and I'm going to start grading some of your work later today. So watch out for grades we put in either later tonight or tomorrow. All right, until Wednesday, we'll talk to you later.